House of Balloons is a horrifying masterpiece. It's been about 11 years since Abel Tesfaye began releasing music under the name The Weeknd, and his journey from a druggy R&B crooner to arguably the most influential and popular pop artist in this decade is honestly almost hard to believe on paper. I mean, the guy was making songs about gang rape and now he's performing at the Super Bowl, it's crazy. But there's something about that older, edgier version of The Weeknd that created this space and music for himself that I don't think we'll ever see again. Nobody really knew who The Weeknd was. A lot of people thought he was a band, some thought a producer and singer combo, but in reality, at the time, there was no evidence of anything. The mysteriousness of this artist felt necessary because of his crude subject matter and the difficult-to-swallow character portrayal, and I think that's what made the original trilogy so appealing. House of Balloons was our introduction to the trilogy of mixtapes, but it was more importantly our first taste of The Weeknd. The endless transparency of this character is uncomfortable. It creates a sense of danger, because his unwavering maliciousness makes him a little bit unpredictable. Let's dive into what makes House of Balloons the most influential R&B record in recent memory, and in my opinion, the most exotic mixtape of all time. Starting off right with the astounding tracklist, Abel gives us really no time to ease into this record because I think High For This is still one of his most climactic tracks. The airy start to the track automatically builds an eerie tone of suspense, as if the world you're entering as a listener is not to be treaded lightly. The soft bass drums finally break the scary spectral atmosphere. It gives the song a little bit of pace, which I think signifies that we are here, we're finally engulfed into this world. I like the double-edged meaning of every line on this track, as it simultaneously begins the narrative of the record while also being a platform for Abel to directly address his audience. On one hand, he's enticing this woman to enter his world, take some drugs, and be quote unquote high for this, and he also wants his listeners to enter into his sonic and vocal fantasy, which he believes would also be better as a listening experience if we were high as well. This track isn't effective just because of its exquisitely ethereal sounds and kind of terrifying atmosphere, or Abel's stunning vocal performance. Thinking retrospectively, High For This serves as an intro not just to House of Balloons, but to The Weeknd as a character and persona. By the end of the track, we get our first taste of him and who he is, and we understand who the character is, what he wants, his motivation for it, and what he's willing to do to get it. When you read the lyrics that Abel's angelic voice is singing, the enticing vibe of the song seems more manipulative, his welcoming attitude malicious, as you realize the encouraging whispers of "I swear, I'm right here," or "I know what you're feeling, I do too," tells us not only that is The Weeknd a veteran at what he's doing, he knows exactly what to say and do to get what he wants. It's this ability to create lore for a character and foundationalize a narrative without directly providing exposition or telling us what the character is feeling or wants us to feel that makes the story in House of Balloons so compelling. We're going to see a lot of examples in the other songs where Abel fills in the blank spaces with tone, production style, or the way he intentionally tells the story in one narrow-minded way. I just wanna take you there. The next track, What You Need, contrasts High For This immediately by starting off with a low-key sound rather than bombastic, and it gets started quickly instead of having a 45-second intro. I'm glad they were able to clear the original sample for streaming services because I think the female utterance of is important to the place that the song holds in the tracklist. The Weeknd has now convinced this person that he is going to give her love and affection, complete her life, all the things that he promised in High For This, and now she has a dependency on him. This is very important for his character's motivation and his goals. It's not about getting what she needs, but what Abel wants. He has just as many voids he needs to fill as the person he's manipulating, but she can provide a fix for him as long as they're together. I've always been mesmerized by how hazy this track is, with Abel's voice sounding quiet and drowned in reverb. It's almost as if the track itself represents the whispers in a woman's ear that seem so convincing and seductive, which hide the true nature of the devil that we're actually dealing with. This cloudy synthesizer loop and the crisp percussions on the chorus just go for this half-asleep, somewhat unsuspecting vibe that I think illustrates the way the woman is feeling in this situation incredibly well. Yet the best part of this track is how flat-out blunt Abel is lyrically. He's juxtaposing the intro track not just sonically, but with the Weeknd character as well. Now that he has seduced the woman he's with, he can be more upfront with his poisonous attitude. The repetitive uttering of, "He's what you want, I'm what you need," makes him feel demonic, like he's the human vessel of temptation and infidelity, asking to sell your body and free will to him in exchange for pleasure. In just two songs, we fully understand that the Weeknd lives this monotonous, dangerous, and frankly, disgusting lifestyle that he's clearly very practiced in, and if you stop listening after just these two songs, we might think we understand the character fully. But that's why House of Balloons, Glass Table Girls is important, because it gives us the most important piece of this character, the misery. The first half, House of Balloons, takes place at one of the XO parties. Everyone is high, Abel is seducing another woman, all things that we already know are mainstays of his character. The title track is the first to have more of a pronounced beat, with subtle marching kicks and snares, and another moaning synth loop, with a rough bass in the background that gives the song this vibrance that has been absent so far. The first verse contains the same slick, confident devil that has manipulated people into joining this world of his, but the chorus gives us our first hint at the Weeknd when he isn't in complete control of a situation. The people at the party are uncomfortable, they've had too many drugs, they want to leave, and the Weeknd sees this and begins almost begging for them to stay, repeatedly stating that this is a happy house, this is fun. And I love the way the chorus ends with Abel just droning on the word fun, over and over and over again, which I always thought was representative of either a panic attack or an emotional breakdown at the idea of what would happen if he was left by himself. And it's here that we first see what I call the front, which is the wall that this character represents. On the song, we see a new dimension of the Weeknd. He's not just a cunning, emotionless sex worshiper. He has these deeply rooted and controlling fears that cause him to be this shallow and harmful person. It's this panic at what might happen if he's lonely that causes the Weeknd to become even more careless for others, because I think that this second verse is arguably the worst he gets on the entire mixtape. The relations with this girl is hurting her day job, and the Weeknd is getting her so high that she's lost and going to quote-unquote burn up. But he ends off the verse by telling her that none of these things are his fault. It's her problem that she chose to come to the party. It's her responsibility to call someone to drive her home, regardless of how high or drunk she is. And frankly, that's what brought me back to House of Balloons from the beginning. It wasn't just the great songs, it was this shocking boldness from a completely unknown artist at the time to be this upfront with how spiteful and horrible he is. Because Abel does this with a purpose. He's completely aware of how frivolous he sounds on the record, and once we understand the character of the Weeknd, we can see the biggest point that he's trying to make with this mixtape.
Taking drugs, and it's bad for me, but I need to do it. And
you know, who is that guy? Because every time I've met you, and I mean, I know you like to go hard as well as work hard, but every time I met you, you seem very super steady of hand. So who is that person in those songs, you know?
I'm a chill person, you know? That guy it is who I am, you know? And, but it is who I am to myself, in my writing. Sometimes you take him and then you create more and then it becomes this beast. And you kind of just add more to him and then, you know, then it's just uncontrollable, his own character. And it just sounds good. He sounds good, you know? And he, it's like Scarface. It's like the villain. It's like, it's horrible, but you can't stop looking at it.
What absolutely boggles my mind about this project is how, if you read into the subject matter and the character arc properly, Abel manages to make a honest case for sympathy despite being arguably the most unapologetically awful persona I've ever heard on a record. See, I feel that House of Balloons is an unspoken commentary. It's unspoken because Abel makes his points without directly addressing them, and it's a commentary because it speaks on the over-glorified value of sex and drugs and how they tend to lead to misery rather than euphoria, which mainstream musicians seem to leave out when they discuss them in their music. He's pointing out that these vices are often a thin veil covering up an artist's flaws or struggles, and the character of The Weeknd feels like a representation of just how scary falling into this trap actually is. Because the loop that Abel creates with House of Balloons' narrative is a paradox. And while it's very specific to The Weeknd's original persona, it also feels general, and like we could apply it to any of the musicians who falsely represent the materialistic infatuation. And this is Abel's self-contrived loop. You have The Weeknd's fear, which is of loneliness, of not truly living, or even of just being a nobody, which causes him to create this front of manipulation and of extracting pleasure and company from his victims, which leads to the parties he's having and these interactions that he details in High for This and What You Need and House of Balloons. But these superficial and dangerous activities don't go on for forever, and so these people that Abel trick eventually leave. So by acting this way, Abel is solving his problem in the short term, but actually prolonging the overarching issue that plagues his character. He's not building actual relationships or finding what he's actually looking for. I think what makes this persona of The Weeknd so sad is that he's really just lost. He believes that sex and drugs will give him what he longs for, but really that's just surface level pleasure. The thing he really needs is love, and he has no idea just how far off the mark he is towards finding it. That vortex to me sums up the lasting artistic value that House of Balloons, but really Trilogy as a whole, has. It alters your perspective of musicians who brag about their money, or women, or celebrity privileges, because if there's anything that The Weeknd shows us, these pleasantries don't give you true satisfaction or happiness. They only leave you wanting more of what you found, because now you're even emptier than you were before you were a rock star. The plot continues when the morning hits, as this introductory electric guitar riff conveys a sense of paradise and blissful joy. The Weeknd has succeeded in his quest to find a lover for the night, as she chose not to leave the House of Balloons, and she stayed to party with The Weeknd and his XO boys. The morning is definitely the closest thing we get to pop music on the record, which I think is slightly a sellout to appeal to a more mainstream and casual demographic. But what impresses me so much about this track is that Abel still finds ways to, one, contribute to the story that he's telling, and two, incorporate layers and thematic indications. There's a couple even more general claims that the track makes. Abel forges a similar concept to High for This, where he's simultaneously addressing the woman he's with, as well as speaking in a general sense at the same time. In verse 2, he speaks his rise to stardom into existence, explaining that he hasn't gotten where he is without struggle and pushing himself beyond his limits. At the same time, he's detailing how he pushes his sexual partners, as if an experience with The Weeknd in bed is like being a virgin again. It's this kind of songwriting that makes Abel so special, because at face value, this verse we just highlighted is pretty basic. It's boring, with dumb subject matter and shallow character writing. However, the way Abel makes this grander statement about his artistry by illustrating his point through the lens of his character The Weeknd is some of the most genius writing I've ever seen. The chorus explains Abel's motivation for pushing his career as far as he can, as well as the motivation for The Weeknd's sexual partners to do what he wants, money. This is another instance where he's just so direct and honest about his disgusting character motivation that it's almost hard to appreciate on the surface. After The Morning, we reach the centerpiece of this mixtape, arguably the most influential R&B song of last decade, the anthem for House of Balloons, but really the theme song for The Weeknd's initial character, and that's Wicked Games. The track's instrumental is paced with a bare drum loop, an airy synthesizer, and a bitterly played piano on the chorus, with a stark electric guitar looming over the drums and piano, rounding the track's sound out with a sinister edge. This song, to me, is a prime example of why worldbuilding and cohesiveness are so important for artistic statements in a piece of work. The sound of House of Balloons, for the most part, is very inorganic and hollow. It's as if the music palette represents the primal desires of The Weeknd and his victims, as the shell of a man is but a zombie who can only understand the bare-boned basics of what he wants. The instrumental on Wicked Games is healthier. It contains more emotion. It's one of two songs on the record where the piano is present. The drums are simple percussions with a much less off-putting edge than, say, What You Need or Glass Table Girls. Because Abel built this world of supernatural and edgy sounds, the vibrance of Wicked Games tells us that we're about to get some transparency from The Weeknd for the first time on this mixtape, without any smoke and mirrors lyrically. And it's on this song where we feel the true misery of The Weeknd's lifestyle really hit home for the first time. He very clearly tells us that all this manipulation, his misogyny, the never-ending escapades for pleasure, they're all really just misguided attempts at searching for love. The pre-chorus and hook provide the meat of his transparency on this track. He begs the person for a one-night stand, as that is how The Weeknd lays his heart out for his lover. When she offers him her body and drugs, he is in position to give her all of himself. This is his never-ending quest for love, as he hopes that once one of these interactions will end in a happily ever after story, and obviously never achieving that goal. Yet, the one-night stands hold him over because he can find love just for one night, which gives him just enough affection to hold him over until he finds someone else. Abel's delivery on this song is probably my favorite out of any song of his. I feel the depression and the desperate hopelessness in every single palpable line he delivers. For the first time, we see that The Weeknd is not just harming others with his nightly escapades, he's a victim of his own actions in this self-compounding downward spiral. This is part of his character he would build on much more on Thursday and Echoes of Silence, as he chooses to revisit the basics that we already know on The Party and The After Party. It's pretty hard for me to pick a definitive favorite out of the 9 undeniably perfect songs on this mixtape, but if I had to choose one, it would definitely be this. This instrumental is haunting. It's a perfectly sped up sample from Beach House's Master of None, defined by this nasally organ, synth keyboards, and a cryptic bass loop. Narratively, The Weeknd has zeroed in on one specific girl. The pleasure she gives him is valuable because it's either of a higher quality or something specific that she does. And the first half of this track is this typical, slick, enticing commentary and invitations that The Weeknd gives to get what he wants from her. The way that his voice flows during the Louis V bag tats on your arms refrain is one of my favorite vocal moments on the tape, but it's also the lyrical centerpiece of The Party. The Weeknd is aware that this girl is wanted by other guys. She's a popular one, but he's not worried because he knows that only he can give her what she needs. This could be referring to sex, but I actually think he's talking specifically about only drugs here, indicating just how deep The Weeknd is willing to go to withhold the power dynamic in a relationship. The chorus makes reference to cocaine and heroin, drugs that are rare and that she might only be able to get from The Weeknd. So the situation that Abel set up is that The Weeknd is doing drugs with this girl in exchange for sexual activity in this relationship where he is pretty much in complete and utter control. But that's why I think The After Party is so jarring, because it gives us this look inside at the emptiness that comes with this system of bartering that he's set up. Abel moves into this monologue of resentment and woe, detailing the Weeknd's depressing lows that follow his grandiose and fast-moving highs. He's taken too much ecstasy, which has him reminiscing on his lifestyle and the irony of what he's doing, pointing out that all the women he thinks he's manipulating and victimizing are actually easier targets than he thinks because they just want him for his potential. Even with this realization, he ends the song by begging this girl for an opportunity to show her what he can do, referring to his typical palette of sex and drugs. My favorite part of the after party is this heavy, watery electric guitar riff that's almost robotic. It makes up most of the instrumental on this part, which I think represents the monotony of the Weeknd's lifestyle and his awareness of that. This brings me to another what I think is a necessary cornerstone of this record's artistic value, which is the incredible exotic sounds that Alangelo and Abel's team of producers were able to provide, which created a world. Not an inviting world or one that you would want to be a part of, more so a twisted dimension, a nightmare that we are thankful we aren't stuck in like the Weeknd. There's a lot of instrumental variety on the record. Look at the different utilizations of the electric guitar. It's used to bring us to paradise on The Morning. To add ominous darkness to Wicked Games. And to add rawness to The After Party. We see this mood variation through other instruments and their utilization as well. I'm thinking of the multiple piano implementations on half of the songs, or the constant switching between live percussion and the use of the 808 drum. Yet, all of these distinct and different instrumentals work as world builders rather than being detrimental to the cohesiveness, because they're never primary. There's one sonic factor retained in almost every song of the nine, which is this alien-sounding remote synthesizers and the similar distorted instruments that just sound hollow. Think about the start of High For This, and the start of Coming Down. While different, the two sounds evoke the same emotions and feelings that The Weeknd creates with his lifestyle. It all just results in a record that sounds devoid, colorless, lacking in emotional depth or earned feelings. When you listen to the sounds through this lens, it makes all of the instrumentals feel like a living and breathing version of The Weeknd. They sound so good, they want you to feel some way, but in reality, they're just hollow. Now that the party and the after party have both ended, The Weeknd is getting over this horrible high he was experiencing in the after party, which brings us to Coming Down. The Weeknd is feeling lonely once more, and he calls what he refers to as his baby, because he always thinks of her when he is coming off of this high. Something disturbing I always reckoned about this song when you think about the fact that it's connected to the party and the after party is that he's calling a girl immediately after he spent the night with this woman he was supposedly obsessed with. It's at this point we have seen the full life cycle of The Weeknd. Party at night, find someone for a one-night stand, get high, then call another person in the morning, and do it over again. It adds another layer to how repulsive Abel's character is, and it does so without directly saying any of that. He laid out this sequence of events in the format of a first-person narrative. He doesn't have to say he lives his life this way, we simply see it. All of his dirty laundry on display right in front of us, and done with some of the best sequential songwriting ever. The track opens with what sounds like this rush of air, and it's looped, and it stays fairly present in the mixing throughout the entire thing. I always felt like it brings the sheer coldness and hollow feeling that represent The Weeknd's utter desperation to escape from his loneliness. And there aren't many other instrumental sounds here besides this gaunt guitar riff that repeats sporadically. It's intentionally bare. It leaves Abel's delivery to take the brunt of the emotional weight this track is trying to deliver. The chorus is repetitive and simple, which seems basic on the surface. Yet the way how each line becomes more dramatic than the last as he drones, "I always want you when I'm coming down," brings out this feeling of anguish at the very idea of not having the instant gratification that The Weeknd is constantly searching for. It's so effective, and it's done so simply, only by layering this powerful vocal delivery that Abel does with just his talent. I originally thought that Loft music was backed by this highly pitched keyboard arpeggio, but then I realized it's actually another Beach House sample, and it's used in such an exotic and powerful way, and this is the only up-tempo song on the entire mixtape. Despite being a bit faster and more spirited than the rest of the record, the aesthetic still lacks color. It retains the coldness that is so essential to the desolate atmosphere of the House of Balloons. I love how Abel switches up on the status quo songwriting-wise. There's no hook or bridge here. The song contains just one verse that is potently laced with sporadic percussions and beat drops, and Abel rapping in this sick flow that shows just how versatile he is as a performer. He offers us even more context in The Weeknd's world, using this verse as an opportunity to give the listener more character depth and world detail as he's wooing another person to join him in his loft to, you guessed it, smoke and have sex. It's at this point in House of Balloons where the lifestyle that The Weeknd is living genuinely starts to scare me. It's obvious just how worthless it is in every single aspect, not only because of the context he gives us, but because The Weeknd has now pointed out multiple times his awareness of the deception between himself and all of his partners. The sad part is that they each have an underlying motive for what they're doing. The Weeknd wants pleasure and to feel like he has power, while the woman he's with wants to take advantage of his popularity and position as an upcoming artist. The Weeknd's bragging about being able to say the same things to girls and still get whatever he wants from them isn't even something he himself believes in. He knows he's not really this slick puppet master he wants the listener to think he is. The outro is then a 3-minute long void of Abel moaning and crying out into oblivion, asking his partner, what's she thinking? What's she doing? The seeming unknowingness and shock in his voice is a perfect setup for the final track that wraps up this plot in a perfect, horrifying little bow. The Knowing is a catastrophically over-the-top crooner, which I always felt was intentional to dichotomize how disturbingly conniving and shameless The Weeknd is, ending off the record by pulling an Uno reverse card on one of his victims who thinks that she can use him. What still boggles my mind about this song is that Abel's performance is so convincing, so emotionally dense, that he tricked everyone into thinking that this song is about heartbreak and sadness at a failing relationship, when in reality, it couldn't be farther away from that idea. The initial beat drop after about 20 seconds of an ambiguous intro brings the soundscape of this album full circle. We hear that same eerie synth arpeggio that's appeared all over the tape one more time, this time giving us an atmosphere of what sounds like the personification of transparency and accepting reality. The Weeknd is with another girl, but whether it's one of the people referenced earlier in the record is unclear. They're in the midst of another sexual encounter, and Abel begins the track by calling her out for her infidelity. So, in an attempt to retain the power and control over the situation, he comes out with the fact that he, too, has also been cheating. And more. And harder. However, he puts one last rattling plot twist in there as he concludes with the fact that all of this is okay. He doesn't mind that they're both sleeping around. She may have thought this knowing would disturb him, but they can keep going just as normal. He then exclaims in a godlike fashion that he knows everything by displaying this staggering vocal potency, looming over this instrumental and this person he's addressing like an all-powerful deity. It's at this point in the mixtape that I think the very telling vocal performance is the only reason that this character hasn't become insufferable with how consciously appalling his actions and attitude continuously are. Because throughout the tracklist, and on this song specifically, I feel like Abel is portraying a very conflicted and trapped persona. While the lyrics read like he doesn't have feelings and the only things that The Weeknd cares about are sex and drugs, I think that the way he delivers the lines and the tone of the instrumentation help us understand that this attitude is really just a front. That front being one The Weeknd contrived in order to abstain from being vulnerable. It's this constant fear and trying to escape from vulnerability that causes him to make every single choice on this mixtape. Despite what he wants us to believe, or what he wants his victims to believe, he does have feelings, he is aware of morality, and they scare him. And that's such a depressing way to live your life. The powerful ambiguity of the knowing is the lack of clarity on whether the Weeknd is hurt by this girl's infidelity, as he's trying so hard to convince us he isn't, or his lifestyle and the monster he's becoming, which would essentially make his own words and actions a self-propagating downward spiral towards living a constantly more and more worthless life. And the only escape he has from these dark thoughts and who he's turning into is these desires, is these temptations, and wielding the endless power he has over satisfying them. And with all that said, we're left at the end of this tape with even more questions than we had before it started. Again, the artistry here is that Abel finds a way to make his character have an argument for actually being the victim in this manipulative, cascading narrative. Is it something that the Weeknd will try to fix? What does it look like when fame is thrown into the mix, or when he actually grows attached to one of the women he's victimizing? These are all questions that he answers on Thursday in Echoes of Silence, which we'll dig into another time. House of Balloons leaves us reeling with a conflicted perception of a misogynistic, drug-induced colossus who has the voice of an angel and the words of the devil. But even the devil has a backstory and a reason for why he is the way he is. This is House of Balloons, a horrifying masterpiece.